自己没有这个设备，那么空军呢委托给他们去做检验工作，他们在那个 X 光底片上面也作假。如果不是因为旧的底片上面有日期跟编码跟现在的不一样的话，还没有人发现。第二个就是当汉翔公司发现了已经被相关部门知道说有造假的嫌疑在里面的时候，他们竟然转包给另外一家叫中联非破坏性检验公司，而这家公司虽然有这个 X 光机，但是也没有进行检验，同样的拿旧的资料旧有的底片来造假。我要重复一遍的是，去年十月就知道的，而且内部都已经了解的，相关部门的首长也都掌握相关的资料，但是不动如山。是不是那个时候相关的国防部的这个首长有可能异动了传闻，所以大家都掩盖住了，避免影响到上面上位者的官位，一直拖到现在尘埃落定了，于是这个就爆发出来。
看来这个弊案的背景是很复杂的，那我们再回过头来讨论一下，目前爆发这起弊案，它所涉及到的是汉翔所负责台军的一个军用教练机的一个维修。那么这个教练机的这个具体情况到底是怎么样的？台军有多少架这样的飞机？这种飞机的故障率高吗？
目前整个台湾有关这个 AT3 或者是 T34 的 AT3 的教练机，目前有60多架，但详细的数目国防部并没有公布，就是60多部。那教练机另外像 T30 有20多架，加起来大概90架左右了。光就第十一修补大队来说，就有25架这个教练机他们去维修的。那么这25架修这个教练机，当然机龄都非常的老旧啊，最起码20岁到25岁左右，甚至比这个年龄还高啊。那因为是汉翔早期还在隶属在政府部门所设计所研发出来的一个给空军官校做学生训练之用的，所以坦白说了，这个零件啊或者各方面基本上当然跟美国或者其他国家的这个机器不能相提并论，但是因为过去这个在维修方面花了很大的时间跟心血，所以到能够到现在为止还堪使用了啊。
那我想江教授，这个不管是军方包给汉翔，汉翔包给中联也好，总之就是没有人去检测。那如果这个飞机的金属疲劳度不经常进行检测的话，它会造成什么样严重的后果吗？
金属疲劳指的是金属就飞机上的机身跟机翼，它经过反复不断加压之后呢，会削弱它的强度跟硬度。那么一旦这个强度硬度出现金属疲劳的情况，飞机一飞上去高速行驶，那个内部的结构不均匀，就会出现裂缝，这个裂缝很容易造成非人为操作性的空难。那么过去有数起这样的情况，包括1985年像日本东京日航客机也是一样，它死亡有520人。那么或者是1981年在台湾的苗栗三一上空华航，也是因为金属疲劳而出现机上110人全数罹难的惨剧。除此以外，在2002年的澎湖上空也出现华航波音747出现金属疲劳的现象，因为这个金属负荷的压力的能量不均匀，所以出现了裂缝扩张啊。那么在2002年呢，出现了澎湖上空第三次重大的空难，总共有225人全数罹难。所以通常这种金属疲劳会造成空难，而且是在空中瞬间解体，完全无法操作做避险的动作，飞行人跟乘客恐怕都必须要付出惨痛的生命代价。
看来这个结果是相当可怕的。那么蔡先生，您所了解到的情况，就为什么台湾空军会把这样一个这么大的30几亿的这样一个工程，一个维修工程包给汉翔？汉翔公司到底是一个什么样的背景呢？
现在如果说你上到汉翔台湾的这个经济部的网站上去查的话，你会发现到一个很有趣的，就是汉翔它的主管单位不是国防部了，它是属于经济部，在经济部里面的一个民间的公司。可是汉翔的高阶主管，甚至包括里面的一些重大的一些重要的研发人员，那么都是谁？你仔细去看他们背景的话，几乎都是军方，特别都是军方的空军的背景，空军的将领啊退下来，然后转到那个地方，或者是空军的专业技术人员转到那个地方。所以他现在最大的问题就在于说，他其实是一个包裹着民营企业的形象，但是实质上呢，是一个台湾的军方，特别是空军的啊，包括高级将领里面研发人才、专业技术人才的一个转业，转到这个地方来。所以他的麻烦也就麻烦在这。理论上来讲的话，他应该是由经济部来管。可是事实上，它的各种特殊的管道跟关系仍然跟原来的空军跟军方有很好的这个互动。在台湾一些比如说专业技术的限制的话，它就可以用限制性的招标。这个道理呢，其实在之前不久的故宫博物院的这个整个改建的工程，其实也出现同样的用限制性招标。
我们看到这一次汉翔是用限制性的招标，也就是说空军给汉翔公司没有其他厂商能够来竞标，就是只此一家，别无分号。那既然是绑约给你的，你就必须要负责到底。可是汉翔公司呢，他竟然还转包给下游的厂商，基本上这是违法的。我刚刚特别强调说，去年10月就知道了，你不能转给别人，就是你要负责到底。如果你没有机器，你要想办法添购新的机器，因为当时空军签约给你这25架交给你维修去检测金属疲劳的，就是要你把机器设备充分弄足了，不然的话，一个30几亿的工程，怎么可能就是限制性招标给你呢？那限制性招标给你，如果你没有设备，你怎么可以去承揽这样工程？所以说中间有太多太多的弊端跟可以值得深究的所在。
那么按照一般的逻辑来说的话，如果承包这项维修工程的公司，也就是汉翔了，他拿了人家的维修费，比如拿了台湾空军的维修费，却从来没有修过飞机，甚至他下面的这个承包公司还制造了假的维修记录，在领取这个维修费用高达7000多万。那么台湾空军为什么会允许这样的事情发生？为什么没有人对汉翔进行管控呢？
这里面呢，又因为汉翔有一个官商好，这个军民之间一个混合过渡的角色，所以就使得汉翔在中间其实有很大的空间可以运用。那谁能管呢？其实很有意思，国防部把军方把这个案子我包给你了，按理说我应该可以管，可是中间就因为我们刚刚讲过，它里面其实汉翔，比如说汉翔的高阶的经理人或者高阶的这个主管，很可能就是原来的空军里面的，比如说我举例子了，空军现在的高阶的，比如说总司令啊，或者是前后期的学弟，或者是前后期的学长学弟的关系，所以它这中间就有很多很复杂的网络。那理论上，其实在这种复杂的网络里头，所有的制度、所有的规范都可能失效。
好的，二位，那我们再来分析最后一个问题，就是这起弊案爆发之后呢，各方都在互相的推诿责任，军方就把责任推给了汉翔公司，汉翔公司又把责任推给了这个中联公司，也就是他们把这个工程外包的那家公司。那么各方都在对外宣称说自己才是受害者。那么江先生，您认为究竟谁应该对这起弊案负起主要的责任？为什么呢？
那目前为止看起来说，谁应该负比较大的责任？责任越高的，权力越大的，就要负比较大的责任，这毋庸置疑。国防单位把这个契约委托汉翔公司，并不表示他就可以推卸所有的责任。维修的工作既然在国防部门，坦白讲，你委托给哪一家那是你的事情，那只是执行面的问题而已，责任当然在国防单位。那国防部的部门的首长，从今年的李杰变成李天宇，一样名字虽然换了，但是相关的部门单位还是要负起至少这个行政监督的责任。但是我要特别强调说，去年10月份就知道这个弊端已经爆发了，空军总司令部也都晓得，但是并没有向国防部门来反映哦，所以大家猜测说这当中是不是有利益输送或者是图利他人的嫌疑。目前为止，其实如果说以这个签约的法律规定来看的话，至少目前汉翔公司跟中联非破坏性检验公司至少涉及到了违约、诈财、伪造文书还有背信啊这4个条文。那么相关的军官目前也被移送法办，但是这个案情如果只是由小军官或者承办人来顶罪的话，恐怕难以渡悠悠众人之口。所以案情能不能向上升继续发展，我觉得有待进一步的观察。
台湾警方已经约谈了跟这起弊案相关的部分责任人，案件呢也还在更深入的调查当中。那么海峡两岸栏目呢也将会对这起弊案持续的关注。好，今天非常感谢二位嘉宾为我们所做的分析，谢谢。
谢谢，
谢谢。
也感谢观众朋友收看今天的海峡两岸，欢迎您继续关注中央电视台中文国际频道的其他节目。
这两杯水一样吗？放入 pH 试纸，1分钟之后，我们就能够看到两杯水的差别。黄色是酸性，绿色是碱性。为了健康，你应该测一测你喝的水。健康的生命需要天然的弱碱性水。
天地有大美，相约长白山。
这里正致力于打造国际纺织品研发中心。啊！
喜庆吉祥，喝农夫果园。
掌声贵子。
人间仙境，山东蓬莱阁。
江北水城，卓越秀美。
一个充满魅力的地方，山东聊城，
吸引海归创业，汇聚创新成果，搭建合作平台，2007中国海外学子创业周。
东万里长城第一关，看秦皇岛外打渔船，中国长城海滨公园秦皇岛，
德通四海，信达天下，上海奥润德。
奥润德地板，完美生活感受，奥润德。
一杯上井高山茶代表着健康，代表着一种文化。如果说好茶能够给我们一个健康的好枕头，你能想象得到吗？这就是一枕茶园茶香枕。
一枕茶园茶香枕，茶叶源自上品高山茶，
茶香清逸，如沐茶园，让您心旷神怡，充分享受大自然的清香和健康睡眠。
文化枕、健康枕、一枕茶园，
享受就从今天开始。
饮料进入原生态保健时代， K 可保健饮料，原生态植物精粹，原滋原味，养育人生，养身健体，喝 K 可，
更真的笑容，
或特殊的一些比如说专业。
台湾我们知道，在谢长廷担任高雄市长任内，因为高雄捷运弊案以及他在当选市长之前所收到的所谓的政治现金的疑案，这些案子呢，对于谢长廷他在整个的参选之路上面会造成一些重大的影响。他首先在有关于高捷弊案的部分，谢长廷的属下以及当时的相关的工程的包商等等，在过去这将近一年的时间以来，纷纷的被约谈，甚至于被起诉。可是谢长廷个人现在有11件的相关弊案在他的身上，但是到目前为止没有任何一个案子被侦结。其中有关于高雄捷运弊案以及政治现金疑案的这个部分，一共有10件，现在都在台湾的特侦组在进行调查之中。而另外那个案子，11件案子的另外那第11件，也就是他的特别费的案子，现在特侦组也在侦查当中。那在6月8号，首先是为了有关于这个政治现金案的这个事情呢，首度的被检方传唤。这个案子就是在民进党在进行党内的领导人初选前夕传出来，甚至于影响到选情的一个关键案子。而这个后续的发展会如何，谢长廷在这个案子之中会不会被起诉，而就算他躲过了这个案子，剩下的9件的高雄捷运弊案，谢长廷又会遭遇到什么样的命运，再再引起关注。其中有一个很重要的一个讯息在于，是谢长廷曾经公开的承诺，如果他的特别费案被起诉的话，他就要退出2008年的大选。但是他却没有讲到高捷弊案的相关的案情，如果被起诉的话，他要退出大选。依照台湾的舆论各界以及民进党和国民党方面大家方面的评估，是说谢长廷方面非常的笃定，认为他在特别费的案子之中应该会过关的。可是在高捷弊案这么错综复杂的相关的案情之中呢，谢长廷能不能过关还在未定之天。所以这个案子如果继续发展下去，假设台湾的司法检调机关是独立的在查这些案件的话，谢长廷想要全身而退是很困难的。那如果一旦谢长廷被起诉的话，是不是第一关就会丧失了作为民进党候选人的资格？而如果一旦谢长廷丧失这样的资格的话，旁边虎视眈眈的苏贞昌是不是就会取而代之？这个是未来对于整个在2008年大选之中影响民进党、影响台湾政坛走向的一个相当关键的因素。
其实对于谢长廷的选情有影响的，不仅仅是他可能涉及到的这个高捷弊案，还有一个问题，也就是谢长廷他究竟会选谁来做他的搭档、做他的副手，这个人选问题也是受到各界关注的。我们先来看一段背景资料。
日前， 民进党2008选举参选人谢长廷的副手人选一直受人关注。由于谢长廷经常与高雄市前代理市长叶菊兰一起出席选举造势活动，因此外界一直盛传叶菊兰将成为民进党2008参选人谢长廷的副手搭档。在6月6号的晚宴上，吕秀莲对叶菊兰表示了祝福：“
我们很高兴，我们第一位女性的。”富国
同出席很多公开的活动，他甚至在他的这个竞选文
些考量之下，到目前为止能够挑选像林苍生这样的一个人之中，表现出来非常不团结的这样子一个形象，所以因为生气，因为愤怒，因为不满王金平，刻意的发出这样子的黑函来打击王金平。当然也有可能来自于绿营啊，是为了要发出这样的黑函来破坏国民党的团结，各种可能性都有啊。但是为什么这样的黑函会造成杀伤力，主要就是马王配破局之后，现在在国民党内依然残存着一个很严重的问题，就是马王不配了，但是马王到底能不能够真心的合作。我们从王金平在马王配破局之后，他在接受一个团体公开演讲的发言过程之中可以看出来，王金平心里头还是充满的相当多的不平和不满的啊。因为在过去的这段时间之中，马王配拖了非常非常的久，然后各种各样的批评呢都涌向了王金平。这个黑函本身来讲，虽然它造成了杀伤力啊，但是呢就整个的国民党内部的团结来说，它算是一个小插曲，不会因为这样子的一个黑函就真实的破坏了国民党的团结。国民党的团结能不能团结，最重要的因素还是在于就是王金平要拿出什么样的态度出来，马英九要拿出一些什么样的政治上面的手腕，真正的能够让王金平以及王金平所属的派系和相关的人诚心诚意的帮助马英九打赢2008年这场选战。
好，今天非常感谢你为我们所做的精彩分析，谢谢。
谢谢。
也感谢观众朋友收看今天的海峡两岸，下期节目我们再见。
那么安特生归还的仰韶文物下落是否有人提起呢？让李宝忠留下的面积4500平方米，展出标本。
他呢？他你们想听我给你们？
是，无意中发现。
大暖化，凡是中国大陆需要的，无不缺货，无不涨价。巴西每分钟消失6块足球场大的雨林，印尼每年有一块瑞士大的森林遭到盗伐，都是为了供应中国市场。全球物价甚至地球存亡问题都和中国绑在一起，不管你借机用人或是积极管理，都无法有效切割。
于是你自残。
民进党7年换了6个阁揆，前任行政院长苏贞昌的大投资大温暖还没让人搞清楚，他就已经被热带气旋给吹跑了。张俊雄旧阁揆新上任，施政报告对他就任内经济负成长2%愤愤辩解，指同个时期新加坡衰退的更多。台湾，台湾，我们安身立命退无思索的台湾，何时开始竟然只能和人比烂？更何况新加坡这几年锐意转型，今年第一季经济成长率已经破9，是我们目标的2倍，我们怎么不比？台湾每人平均 GDP 1998年领先南韩80%，2004年开始竟然落后南韩，至今民进党怎么说？南韩的外汇存底眼看就要超过台湾了，我们的官员说外汇存底太多也不是什么好事。外汇存底不是向来是台湾的奇迹和骄傲吗？怎么忽然太多也不是好事了？其实外汇存底先追过台湾的可能不是南韩，而是俄罗斯。台湾到底要这样一名一名被挤到哪里去呢？瑞士洛桑管理学院刚公布年度报告，大陆竞争力首度超越台湾，而我们的官员的反应是，不是台湾太差，而是大陆进步得太快。不进则退，老师不是早就教了吗？你有没有在听？台湾的人口盖在消失，走路一不小心就会掉进黑洞里，这种新闻多到连地方版都懒得登了。但令人战栗的是，真正掉到黑洞里的其实是台湾的竞争力，而我们居然无所谓。
马来西亚总理巴达维在今天迎娶第二任妻子。我要回来更多国际讯息，马上告诉您。
乒乓看中国，水饺在龙凤，
准备开动。怡宝，现大，原汁多多。乒乓看中国，水饺在龙凤。
综合报道，
我们从一部电
影宽鼻子又不挺，实在应该去整形才对。不过选美
，We will do better, definitely.
The two points you have made sound pretty defensive in nature, but do you think your Western counterparts in the negotiations with which you have been involved for many times can fully understand the concerns of the Chinese authorities and understand the Chinese agenda in?Achieving these goals set forth largely by our Western players.
Well, I think you have mentioned indeed a very important point, namely communication or mutual understanding. In fact, that is part of the reason why the Chinese government has all along emphasized so much the importance of international cooperation, as we have conducted over the past so many years. And even in the bilateral way, it is our belief and our hope that we couldensure that each party can, to the best extent possible, understand the other's concern and try as much as possible to accommodate each other's concern. It is only through this kind of friendly dialogue and consultation can we, in the best possible way, address the existing problems or bilateral concerns.
Given the growing integration of China into the international economic order, there have been widespread and very extensive coverage on what's happening here in this country. And an important part of the Western media coverage about this country has always been trade disputes as well as IPR protection. And a lot of the criticisms target what we have failed to do. Do you think the Western media is deliberately building up pressure?And that has served as a strong incentive for China to make a really remarkable progress. What do you think of this sort of approach?
Just putting a set approach adopted by the Western media, let me share with you how I view the soul of journalism. I think the very soul and essence of journalism should be respect for facts, mm-hmm. as well as impartial and objective reporting. So over the past 20 years, China has achieved so much in terms of enforcement. We havemobilized more than 300,000 people working in the enforcement and judicial bodies. And last year, we established across the nation 50 IPR service centers and opened a service hotline of 12312 so as to listen to the IPR-related complaints. All those efforts are fairly effective in cracking down on piracy. And even according to a lot of international community assessment as well as industrial association, China's performance has been improving really, really very considerably. For example, the former Director General of WIPO, the World Intellectual Property Office, Mr. Bogosh,once said that China has accomplished all its current achievements in a speed unmatched in the history of IP protection. And also James Zimmerman, who is the president of American Chamber of Commerce in China, at an April high-level forum on IPR protection held in this country, saying that China really has made marvelous progress on all fronts of intensified efforts for IPR protection. And BSA, you know, the Business Software Alliance of the United States,recently commented China saying that over the past 3 years, the piracy rate in this nation has been cut by 10%. And this, I think, is even a better performance than some of our negotiating partners, as you mentioned, the United States. Because according to the same organization, at this stage, the U.S. has seen as high as 23% piracy rate of the Microsoft's operating system on its own market.
Mm-hmm. The focus of today's interview is really about the protection of IPR. And one of the issues concerning this area, I'm afraid, is the legislative work. What do you think of the progress that China has made, if any, in this particular regard?
Actually, I think legislation has been one of the very highlights of China's achievements in its IPR protection over the past 20 years, and its efforts so far have been widely acknowledged by the international community, because over the past decades, we have put into place already a rather full and international rules-compliant legal system composed of not only laws, but also regulations. You will find very diversified sources of China's legal documents, because not only we will find professional laws such as trademark law, patent law, and copyright law, but also in the more general and more specialized laws such as criminal law, contracts law, or even anti-unfair competition law, you will find specific IPR dedicated clauses or sections. Moreover, we have got the State Council regulations and mm-hmm. departmental rules, as well as the Supreme Court. Though China has not been any early bird in the field of IPR legislation, we have tried our best to take into consideration a lot of important factors, for example, China's current economic development level, as well as the international obligations we should observe, since China has already been a party to almost all the major international conventions, treaties concerning IPR protection. Mm-hmm. It's especially worth mentioning that during the course of China's preparation for its WTO accession, we have conducted a very thorough effort to review and amend our domestic legal system, IPR-related ones included, of course, so as to bring them completely in line with the WTO rules, especially the TRIPS agreement. And we have done that. Pascal Lamy, the Director General of the WTO, at the end of last year, commended China's good compliance with the WTO rules in all aspects, of course, including IPR protection.
Let's take a closer look at the issue within the framework of the WTO. The trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights, the so-called TRIPS, is an important international convention on IPR protection and enforcement. China has been a WTO member for 5 years. What's your comment on this convention called the TRIPS?
Yeah, TRIPS, as you rightly pointed out, it was actually one component of the whole single undertaking documents agreed upon at the end of the 8th multilateral trade negotiations, as we so call it, the Uruguay round. It was endorsed in the 1993, at the end of that year, and became valid formally on the first day of 1995. This TRIPS agreement, with its wide coverage and very high level of IPR protection, as well as a strong binding force, has been holding a very important role in the whole WTO system. And it is one of the agreements that have to be observed and enforced by each and every WTO member. I should say that this agreement, in its very design and final wording, has taken into full consideration the actual situation and economic development level of all the WTO members, including developing countries. It has well stricken a balance between, if you like, rights and obligations. So therefore, it is widely recognized and supported by the whole WTO contracting parties. Talking about China, we are still a developing country, as you know, and on our way marching forward towards better IPR protection, we have indeed encountered with some difficulties and problems. But that never ever slowed our efforts in intensifying IPR protection. Instead, we have bring ourselves in full compliance with the TRIPS
provisions. What are the problems and challenges we are facing?
Coming back to the basic national condition of China, China is a country, a big developing country with altogether 1.3 billion people, out of which something like 800 million are dwelling in the rural areas. So it has taken China a very long time to get those people enough food and enough thing to wear. And even today, we still face the arduous task of getting some people out of the absolute poverty line. But given these circumstances, it is understandable how difficult it is for us to generally spread the idea of intellectual property rights to every corner of the Chinese society. That is one very basic fact that nobody can deny. Even our leadership never tries to cover this fact. Actually, you cannot expect anyone, when he does not enjoy enough food, to think about anything so high as IPR protection. But given this, the Chinese government's firm determination to strengthen IPR protection remains unchanged. The reason is that we have taken note of the important role of innovation and of creation and the importance of protecting people's intellectual assets and creativity so as to boost the whole country's development. So we will remain firm, whatever happened, on this track. We will continue along this line. But still, we have to mention and we have to be sober-minded about the basic national condition. And that is what we have been repeatedly telling the outside world. Despite of all the progress we have made so far, you have to focus on China's national condition. You have to understand and please offer understanding to China's national conditions.
All right, thank you very much. You are watching Dialogue with Ms. Yuan Yuan, Assistant Spokesperson from the Ministry of Commerce. We are talking about the IPR protection in China. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
They are not just big names, but great minds. When you look them in the eye, you discover vision and wisdom. It's not just Q&A, but highly interactive. When we start talking, the dialogue becomes a testing ground for novel ideas and a battlefield for diverse views between East and West. Stay tuned for Dialogue, a vibrant exchange of views on positions and policies, emotions and reasoning.
With Linglong Tire, there will be no uneven road in the world.
CCTV 9, China's only English language news channel, broadcasts throughout China and across the globe. CTV Golden Bridge is CCTV International's exclusive advertising agent and can put your company in touch with an audience of millions.
Welcome back. Well, the image of China is very important. It's something that not only the Western media has been keen on covering, but also a top concern of many of the Chinese here. What do you think of the issue of China's enforcement in ensuring IPR protection? Is there anything that we are proud of?
Of course.
Or something we should feel ashamed of?
Of course, something proud of, definitely. Ashamed of, never heard of that. You know, enforcement has been one of the focus, as you rightly put it, especially among the Western media and the Western world, when it comes to the topic of China's IPR protection. I think one of the reasons is because when you have laws written on the paper, one very difficult job is how to get it implemented and delivered, given the case of China's vast territory, so many different places and the various levels of education and people's livelihood and economic development level. But I should say, over the past 20 years, China has really been very brilliant in putting into place a system of enforcement featuring dual track of administrative and judicial protection. By that I mean, on the one hand, we have set up several specific departmental agencies to take care of the various varieties of IPR categories listed in TRIPS, for example, copyright. We have got the NCAC, the National Copyright Administration of China, to take care, and we've got patent under the leadership of the SIPO, or State Intellectual Property Office, and the job of part of the job of SAIC, the State Administration for Industry and Commerce, is to look at the trademark protection thing in this nation. And customs, of course, will be held accountable for the IPR enforcement efforts on borders or in the import and export stage. So these are what we call the administrative channel. So far, this enforcement channel has been proved highly effective. And on the other hand, we do have a judicial protection channel where we have the public security bodies and the procuratorates as well as the courts joining their efforts together to ensure effective cooperation, effective protection. And for a right holder, once you have found your rights and interests infringed upon by a violator, you can choose either way to go to the administrative body for a settlement or just go to court. It's up to you. So that is part of the reason why we believe we have indeed achieved a lot in terms of the enforcement. And as I quoted earlier, the BSA number, namely the 10% decline of the pirated software, is a good evidence here, because without such enforcement efforts, how can you make sure that data cannot automatically come down, right? But apart from that, I should say we have, ever since 2004, established one very effective national mechanism, and that is the so-called National Working Group on IPR Protection, mainly responsible for the whole country's IPR enforcement work, headed by very famous Vice Premier Madam Wu Yi. And under this leadership, we have got interparliamentary efforts to involving both the administrative organs and the judicial departments to work together to ensure a nationwide effective IPR protection. And moreover, starting from 2006, we have formulated this, which is the action plan on China's IPR protection. We have so far been formulating and publicated two pieces, both are bilingual languages and made available through important channels as trade fairs and Canton Fair, for example, the Central China Expo, as well as high-level forum on IPR protection. It was also given as gifts or reading materials, if you like, after important bilaterals to foreign guests.
Let's look at the regional characteristics of the IPR issue. Do you think countries can fight the battles alone, or do you think more should be done to strengthen the international coordination?
Of course, not alone. The IPR protection is not at all a specific regional issue, but instead it is of global nature. By that I mean we have, in a lot of case detection, found cross-border IP violating criminal activities, if you like, involving some linkages or certain stages of the production or of the sales located elsewhere, some of them in the United States. So that is why we emphasize a lot on the international cooperation, especially through the bilateral channels for information sharing, for clue provision. For example, when we are talking about IP violation, it is very hard for us in such a huge country to know specifically where the hideouts are for those infringers. But if a foreign IP holder, you have got a clue, we warmly welcome you to complain, to lodge a complaint to our IPR service centers. And so long as we got that clue, we will look very seriously into those things.
Do you mean we have a specific telephone number for those to voice hotline. Their complaints? The hotline has
been established. We have got a hotline, across all the 50 service centers we have established in medium-large cities in China last year, and the number is 12312. You can call it if you like. So we have to, through this bilateral or multilateral international cooperative efforts, to cut off the whole chain of the cross-border IPR infringement. This is for one thing. For the second thing, I think sometimes we are really curious about the pirated DVDs. How come some of the blockbusters, even never put on the screen in the United States, already got fake copies or pirated copies here on the Chinese market? So where is the source of this master copy? I'm sure that we have to think about the very source of the country where it was born, you know? Because we will be having no way in going to that country and having that copy, which is yet released to the general public, and get it pirated.
So the evil got to be stopped at the point of its origin. In terms of where we have the source, that's a very interesting point. What can we do to make overseas observers of China's IPR protection feel more confident? Because it seems to be a big issue that a lot of those in the West are very suspicious about what is being done by the Chinese authorities to reduce violations of IPR and, of course, trademarks infringement as well.
I think parts of the reasons we have already covered, that is due to the lack of an objective enough or comprehensive enough reporting by the Western, by some or certain Western media. So the Western people are yet, some of them are yet to be equipped with a comprehensive picture of China's real considerate efforts as well as marvelous achievements in IPR protection. But talking about how to boost confidence, I think two things. First, fundamentally, we will continue our efforts of protecting IPR in an effective way. And one very specific move we're going to take during the course of this year is to well implement this 2007 action plan. These are not written only for paper, for white and black, but to be delivered in action. Actions speak louder than words, as we strongly believe it. For example, we are going to formulate and amend 14 rules and regulations this year, and we are going to promulgate another 7 judicial interpretations and guiding opinions so as to ensure more effective guarantee of IPR protection. And secondly, we are going to wage tougher battle against infringement. especially for those most problematic industries or places, as you mentioned, some of the markets. And thirdly, we're going to ensure better services offered by the already established IPR service centers to make their services more convenient for the IP holders to enjoy. And fourthly, we can expect the promulgation of a national strategy of IP protection. It is already known that China has identified the IP protection as a national strategy, and the formulation of the strategy is expected to be completed before the end of this year. I think that will be a very strong impetus to the overall efforts of China's IP protecting campaign. Moreover, as always, education and training remains a top priority of the Chinese government, and we will continue to do that. Talking about the vast majority of the people, we need to educate the society. And we have an annual IPR Publicity Week held in every April. And I think that has been a very effective way to make the concept of IP known to more people, to make known to them that it is harmful to use fake fertilizer, you know, and you will get no crops at all when the harvest season comes out, etc. We will let the local people know about those things. And apart from these specific measures, I think one other very important thing, perhaps of even more critical importance as I see it, is further strengthening of international cooperation. Part of it we have already discussed about how to enhance mutual understanding, but another thing is about publicity. I think talking about a correct or a fair publicity of China's IPR performance, we need the help and concerted efforts of both Chinese media and the Western media. The Western media we have analyzed and you have analyzed. The Chinese media, you are here, and I really very appreciate this opportunity to invite me to be here and share with the viewers of this program what is the position of the Chinese government and what we have done. Apart from this, actually, we have many other channels, for example, the regular or irregular press conferences held either by the competent IPR agencies in China or by the State Council Information Office. Important and useful information can be delivered there as well. Also, China, having in mind the fact that a lot of foreigners cannot read and write Chinese at this stage, though some of them do, and very fluent, we have opened an official website for IP protection. And you can get access to it at www.ipr.gov.cn. So documents of this kind in both Chinese and English languages can be found there, as well as the latest news and achievements and measures adopted by the Chinese government. So it's all about communication, my second part. I think apart from what we have done in real sense, earnestly, of course, that is the foundation. You have to do this thing, and we will do this thing definitely for our own good, not at all out of external concerns, as you mentioned, or just purely for living up to our international standards. But secondly, to have better understanding of the other's actual situation, be realistic, will be very helpful to the Western world.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Welcome for President Hu Jintao as he begins his state visit to Sweden. Senior leaders are among the visitors to a new exhibition celebrating China's cultural heritage. A landslide killed three people while floods forced hundreds of thousands of people to flee their homes in Guangdong. And the Chinese community in Costa Rica celebrates the country's decision to forge diplomatic ties with China.
Hello and welcome to China Today. I'm Zhou Yue in Beijing. President Hu Jintao has arrived in the Swedish capital Stockholm for a state visit. Swedish King Carl Gustaf met the president and his wife Liu Yongqing. Liu Yang has more.
The royal reception shows the importance of the visit, which envisions further expansion of the trade relations.Last year, the volume of trade between China and Sweden reached $6.7 billion. That makes China Sweden's largest trading partner in Asia. More cooperation agreements are expected to be signed during this visit. King Carl Gustaf and Queen Sylvia met with Hu Jintao and his wife Liu Yongqing at the Royal Palace.The king and the president then inspected the Swedish royal guards. Lastly, Swedish ministers headed by Prime Minister Fredrik Reinfeldt came up to welcome the president.President Hu and his wife well stayed 2 days in Sweden. In a written statement, Hu noted that in recent years, China and Sweden have built strong trade and business ties. During this visit, he and Swedish leaders will review past progress and explore new ways to strengthen mutually beneficial cooperation. Liu Yang, CCTV.
And earlier on, CCTV reporter Xiang Jian met with the Swedish ambassador to China, Michael Lindstrom, and talked about President Hu Jintao's visit to Sweden and Sino-Swedish relations.
Ms. Ambassador, thanks for your time for this interview. President Hu Jintao's visit to Sweden will be the first by a Chinese head of state since the two countries established diplomatic relations in 1950. What's the significance of this visit?For Sino-Swedish relations?
As you're saying, first of all, the visit has a symbolic importance. I would say never in the history of China and Sweden, if you go back in time, never has an emperor of China, never has a president of China visited Sweden. So there is an enormous symbolic significance in this visit. But visits are more than symbols. They can also be very operationally important. The president is coming accompanied by five ministers and a delegation of about 100 people. And I hope that we will set processes into motion that will help us in the years to come to continue discussions that were started when the president comes to Sweden. So I hope that this will also help to promote the working day-to-day relations between China and Sweden.
Last year saw the visit to China by King of Sweden, as well as retracing of a historical journey to China by Swedish ship Gothenburg. Was 2006 a milestone in Sino-Swedish relations?
Yes, we have a beautiful parallel. The Swedish, their majesties, the King and Queen of Sweden, came here invited to China by the president on a state visit, and now we have the state visit in the other direction. I think you can see almost like an image, the bridge between China and Sweden, the two halves are meeting. And in fact, the ship Gothenburg is also a symbol. It reminds us of the peaceful trade that we had 250 years ago.
In 2004, the first Confucius College in Europe was established at Stockholm University. Do you think Swedish people now understand China better than we understand Sweden? And how should we increase our mutual understanding?
Oh, that's a very good question. I can tell you that there is a record number of young Swedish people who want to study Chinese. So China is mentioned almost every day in our newspapers. There's a lot of curiosity about China and Sweden. But also coming here in China, I noticed that the Swedish model is often referred to in political debate and social debate, that Sweden has found the methods of dealing with the rights and wrongs of society and justice in society and how to include everyone in the welfare system and so on. So in China, I notice also a lot of curiosity about Sweden. It's a potentially wonderful situation right now.
In which areas do you think the two countries should collaborate more?
Well, I think all the way from politics to culture to technology. We have more than 100 agreements already between Swedish universities and Chinese universities. And clearly in the areas of science and innovation and industry, there are enormous possibilities for both our countries. But culture, we should not forget culture and people-to-people contacts. They're also very important.
Thanks, Mr. Ambassador. Thank you so
much. It's a pleasure to have you here. Good luck.
President Hu Jintao met leaders of the 8 major industrialized countries on Friday on the sidelines of the G8 summit in Germany. Bilateral relations and joint efforts to meet global challenges were the main concerns of the Chinese president in those talks. Zhou Jun has the story.
President Hu Jintao told President George W. Bush that China and the U.S. should continue to cultivate strategic mutual trust, objectively view the development, and correctly understand the strategic intention of the other. President Hu Jintao urged the U.S. side to properly handle the Taiwan issue and jointly maintain peace and stability across the Taiwan Strait.He stressed that both should meticulously maintain the overall situation in Sino-U.S. trade, comprehensively and objectively view the problems during the rapid growth of their economic cooperation. Hu Jintao said the China-U.S. strategic dialogue, as well as the joint commissions of trade, economy, science and technology, should play a bigger role. He added that economic and trade frictions should be dealt with by equal dialogue and consultation, and the politicization of trade issues should be avoided. Hu Jintao also suggested expanding cooperation and consultation in such areas as energy, environmental protection, and climate change. This could contribute to maintaining the world's energy security, combating global climate change, and improving habitat.He also called
China's legislative efforts. This is for one thing. Also, though China has not been any early bird in the field of IPR legislation, we have tried our best to take into consideration a lot of important factors. For example, China's current economic development level, as well as the international obligations we should observe, since China has already been a party to almost all the major international conventions, treaties concerning IPR protection.It is especially worth mentioning that during the course of China's preparation for its WTO accession, we have conducted a very thorough effort to review and amend our domestic legal system, IPR-related ones included, of course, so as to bring them completely in line with the WTO rules, especially the TRIPS agreement. And we have done that. Pascal Lamy, the Director General of the WTO, at the end of last year, commended China's good compliance with the WTO rules in all aspects, of course, including IPR protection.
Let's take a closer look at the issue within the framework of the WTO. The trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights,the so-called TRIPS, is an important international convention on IPR protection and enforcement. China has been a WTO member for 5 years. What's your comment on this convention called the TRIPS?
Yeah, TRIPS, as you rightly pointed out, it was actually one component of the whole single undertaking documents agreed upon at the end of the 8th multilateral trade negotiations, as we so call it, the Uruguay round. It was endorsed in...the 1993 at the end of that year and became valid formally on the first day of 1995. This TRIPS agreement, with its wide coverage and very high level of IPR protection, as well as a strong binding force, has been holding a very important role in the whole WTO system. And it is one of the agreements that have to be observed and enforced by each and every WTO member. I should say that this agreement, in its very design and final wording has taken into full consideration the actual situation and economic development level of all the WTO members, including developing countries. It has well stricken a balance between, if you like, rights and obligations. So therefore, it is widely recognized and supported by the whole WTO contracting parties. Talking about China, we are still a developing country, as you know, and on our way marching forward towards better IPR protection.We have indeed encountered with some difficulties and problems. But that never, never ever slowed our efforts in intensifying IPR protection. Instead, we have bring ourselves in full compliance with the TRIPS provisions.
What are the problems and challenges we are facing?
Coming back to the basic national condition of China, China is a country, a big developing country with altogether 1.3 billion people, out of which something like 800 million are dwelling in the rural areas. So it has taken China a very long time to get those people enough food and enough thing to wear. And even today, we still face the arduous task of getting some people out of the absolute poverty line. But given these circumstances, it is understandable how difficult it is for us to generally spread the idea of intellectual property rights to every corner of the Chinese society. That is one very basic fact that nobody can deny. Even our leadership never tries to cover this fact. Actually, you cannot expect anyone, when he does not enjoy enough food, to think about anything so high as IPR protection. But given this, the Chinese government's firm determination to strengthen IPR protection remains unchanged. The reason is that we have taken note of the important role of innovation and of creation and the importance of protecting people's intellectual assets and creativity so as to boost the whole country's development. So we will remain firm whatever happened. On this track, we will continue along this line, but still, we have to mention and we have to be sober-minded about the basic national condition, and that is why we have been repeatedly telling the outside world, despite of all the progress we have made so far, you have to focus on China's national condition. You have to understand and please offer understanding to China's national conditions.
All right, thank you very much. You are watching Dialogue with Ms. Yuan Yuan, Assistant Spokesperson from the Ministry of Commerce. We are talking about the IPR protection in China. Don't go away, we'll be right back.
They are not just big names, but great minds. When you look them in the eye, you discover vision and wisdom. Dialogue, a vibrant between East and West. Stay tuned for Dialogue, a vibrant exchange of views on positions and policies, emotions and reasoning.
With Ling Long Tire, there will be no uneven road in the world.
CCTV 9, China's only English language news channel, broadcasts throughout China and across the globe. CTV Golden Bridge is CCTV International's exclusive advertising agent and can put your company in touch with an audience of millions.
To strengthen the international coordination.
Of course, not only IPR Publicity Week held in every April. And I think that has been a very effective way to make the concept of IP known to more people, to make known to them that it is harmful to use fake fertilizer, you know, and you will get no crops at all when the harvest season comes out, etc. We will let the local people know about those things. And apart from these specific measures, I think one other very important thing, perhaps of even more critical importance as I see it, is further strengthening of international cooperation. Part of it we have already discussed about how to enhance mutual understanding, but another thing is about publicity. I think talking about a correct or a fair publicity of China's IPR performance, we need the help and concerted efforts.
The king and the president then inspected the Swedish royal guards. Lastly, Swedish ministers headed by Prime Minister Fredrik Reinfeldt came up to welcome the president.
Peace and stability across the Taiwan Strait. He stressed that both should meticulously maintain the overall situation in Sino-US trade, comprehensively and objectively view the problem in drawing up a comprehensive plan for investment cooperation. He said China encourages its companies to invest in Russian industries such as infrastructure, processing, manufacturing, high technology, timber, and
praised, many of them became as confused as they were flattered. Paper cutting, wood prints, marionettes, abundant histories and culture impregnated each piece of the exhibits here. Modern ways of life are drawn out these handicrafts in an accelerating pace. And getting lost with them will be a wealth of human wisdom.
I often go to Shanxi province, where almost every woman is an expert at paper cutting. But in recent years, I see fewer and fewer windows decorated with these handmade paper images. For young people, paper cutting is out of fashion. They just don't...
100 million yuan or 75 million US dollars. In Guangdong, the figure is over 90 million yuan or 20 million US dollars. But the situation could still get worse. Weather forecasters say rainstorms will continue to lash the region over the next 2 days. Local authorities are coordinating resources to save lives, and so far no more casualties have been reported. Officials have built temporary shelters and are providing food and clean water for homeless people. Pandong, CCTV.
The National People's Congress of China and the U.S. Senate have wrapped up their fourth meeting under a parliamentary exchange mechanism. The two legislative bodies hope to cooperate more on energy and environmental protection. The two sides exchanged views on the Taiwan issue and the Darfur peace process. Arriving in Washington early this week, the NPC delegation held meetings with U.S. Vice President Dick Cheney and Senate President pro tempore Robert Byrd and other congressional leaders. Quarantine authorities in Guangdong have found white ants in a shipment of U.S. imported nuts. Experts say the insects pose a serious threat to China's trees and ecosystem. The ants were found in a 2-ton shipment of rotting pistachio nuts. The milky white ants are a dangerous species and are strictly prohibited under China's food import laws. Inspectors say the shipment of nuts are transported directly to China without transferring. The shipment passed U.S. quality tests and arrived with an official certificate. Guangdong authorities say they will destroy all the nuts and help the Chinese importer to seek compensation. Over in Costa Rica's capital, San Jose, the Chinese community is celebrating the country's decision to end its relationship with Taiwan. Analysts believe that as the mainland's market grows, allies of Taiwan are increasing.
Best solution.
Spain is the third country after France and Germany where the photo show has been held. The exhibition were all organized by councils of local overseas Chinese for the promotion of China's peaceful reunification. Zhuhua, CCTV.
And finally, the Hong Kong Discipline Services are responsible for maintaining security and...
1998年7月,在浙江省慈溪市开办工艺编织工厂已3年的台商王新茂发现，自己的妻子李美玲和以前有些不太一样。他总是喜欢一个人。
好，中国财经报道。
最近，我们中国财经报道记者在华北地区进行了一轮走访，发现水资源透支的问题正在直接影响着当地的用水安全。最新的数据显示，仅河北省地下水累计超采近千亿立方米，接近两条黄河的径流量。面对这样惊人的数字，很多人用忧心忡忡形容自己的心情。华北地区的水危机自然而然地引发了一场声势浩大的华北保水战。
2007年，对邢台巨鹿巡虎村的冯祥臣一家来说，有太多的不幸。几天前，正当壮年的大哥因为癌症离开了人世，冯祥臣的老母亲逢人就哭。老冯说，村里这些年得癌症的人不少，大多还都是年轻人。村里还有许多人得了骨质增生，离了拐杖就没法走路，老冯的母亲也是其中一个。
我这都变下脚了，根本不一样，你不学都不愿学，都不爱想，我要孩子都成天说，你们叫各位沉也沉不沉。
眼瞅着得病的人越来越多，村里人也没少嘀咕，是不是村里的井水出了问题？
像这个50岁左右，这个得这个骨质增生的，像颈椎的还是特别多。但是那时候还都因为都是反映说是不是水的问题，是吧？都老是反映一直有问题。但是一人都趁你们弄村也一人还就水质，人家村就静静还花要多，就水还生硬，就是水质变质了。
不管是南方还是北方，农村主要水源还是打井抽水。按照水利部门的划分标准， 地下150米以上的水被称为浅层水，150米以下的水被称为深层水。正常情况下，井打到3-5十米深就能找到符合饮用标准的水源，而在巡虎村，300米的深水井打出来的水也有苦咸味儿。巡虎村的人也想过再重新打一口深井，可打一眼深井要4万多块钱，村里实在拿不出这么多钱。于是全村3000多口人跑到3里外的邻村买水吃，一次买上1吨半吨的，存在自家院的水缸里，够吃上个把月。
没水吃，他往里买。
嗯，那你这个就是你承包了这个井还是？
啊，承包，
承包。
村民老袁告诉记者，他承包的这眼深水井一天能出200多吨水，是周围3-4个村几千口人的主要水源。记者估算了一下，每吨水按1.2块收费，刨去电费和维修费用，老袁每天的收入不算少。邻村的王继和看着卖水收入不错，自己干起了送水的营生。焊一个水罐2000多块钱，加上拖拉机，王继和花了10000多块钱置办了送水的家当，开始给各村的乡亲们送水。
和村家外村了又送水了，但是后外村送水不方便，不方便在俺村了焊了几个盏罐，就是家家户户都家这个数，拉几摊水起几个月。
水罐装得满满的，能盛4吨水。王继和从水井拉水，给承包水井的老袁4块钱，再开着拖拉机送到各家各户去，按照路程的远近不同，收取不同的费用。没有的
不给了。近点10块，挂水的地方近着是10块。
远
处的地方。
然后把符合饮用标准的深层水抽出来，从地下管道直接输送到临近的几个村。这样既能解决贫困村没钱打井的吃水难题，又能达到对有限的地下水资源进行统一调度的节水目的。
比如这个水厂，这个水厂的话，它是供了这个3000多户11000多人，就是供这一片这几个村庄都有这一个水厂供。
在邢台南宫市水务局，已经
吐了压实上你可以看出来，这一部分
意味着减少两
例，很少，大概就是2000多万，所以我们每年，拿出这个维修费来也很少，基本上是维护经费基本上没有，我们只能靠我们水库管理处
实施节水措施之后，
机构加强技术手段，力争从根本上切断淫秽色情网站利用银行系统开展非法经营活动的资金渠道。
据了解，由于数额较小，交易频繁，隐蔽性强，淫秽色情交易发现较为困难。银行业金融机构将切断淫秽色情网站收费渠道纳入到商业银行风险管理和安全管理的体系，进行全面风险管理，采取协议约束，建立专门联系机制，建立网上支付预警系统等措施，加大核查力度。一旦发现合作网站从事淫秽色情活动，立即终止合作关系。对于一些非银行的支付网关，各商业银行也通过协议进行约束，
不断完善监管措施，加大监管力度，督促银行机构进一步认真查找内控漏洞，严格执行开户结算等规定，依法配合公安部门对这些可疑银行账户的调查查处工作，防止呢网络淫秽色情活动利用银行网络支付结算平台和工具来转移资金。
针对美国食品和药品管理局6月1号已从中国的牙膏中检出了含量最高为4%二甘醇为由，对中国牙膏采取扣留措施这一行为，国家质检总局表示将向美国食品和药品管理局就此事进行交涉。
中国卫生部组织专家对牙膏中二甘醇的危害性进行的评估表明，二甘醇属低毒类化学物质，进入人体后代谢排出迅速，用在牙膏中主要起保湿润滑作用。目前没有资料显示因使用二甘醇牙膏而直接导致人体中毒的案例。国家质检总局相关负责人介绍说，目前美国食品和药品管理局对我国3家企业的13个品牌牙膏进行了扣留。
中国的牙膏生产企业在向美国出口之前，都通过进口商把牙膏的配方，向美国的 FDA， 也就是食品药品管理局做了申报，含有二甘醇的都在配方中标明了含量。 那么这些配方呢，都经过了美国食品药品管理局的审查，也都获得了他们的标签注册。美国 FDA 呢，同意这样一些产品向美国出口。那么现在呢，他采取这样的措施，我们认为是不科学的，也是不负责任的。同时，我想指出，这也是自相矛盾的。我们国家质检总局啊，对这个问题高度关注，我们已经向美国的 FDA 提出了交涉，希望他妥善地处理这个问题。
这里是著名的爱国主义教育基地重庆歌乐山军统集中营，它是国民党军统从1939年到1943年秘密修建的监狱，其中最为臭名昭著的是白公馆和渣滓洞。在重庆解放的前夜，先后有300多共产党员和革命志士在这里献出了宝贵生命。我只能期待着那一天，地下的火冲腾，把这活棺材和我一起烧掉，我应该在烈火和热血中得到永生。这首不朽的诗篇《囚歌》就是叶挺将军在歌乐山监狱中写成的。在白公馆，徐小轩、韩子栋等组成的秘密党组织编出了《狱中挺进报》，把中共七届二中全会召开、百万雄师过长江等重要消息传送给狱中难友。在渣滓洞，李清林、江竹云等人用手指写下《新民主主义论》《论共产党员的修养》等文章的主要内容，供大家学习，坚定信仰。面对种种酷刑，共产党人和革命志士在狱中同敌人进行了艰苦卓绝的斗争。1957年，《革命回忆录》在烈火中永生问世。1961年12月，根据回忆录而创作的小说《红岩》出版发行，先后被译成10多种文字，发行上千万册，被誉为革命的教科书。
下面请看一组简讯。
2007年安全生产万里行活动今天启动，主题为综合治理保障平安。人民日报、新华社、中央电视台等新闻单位组成的采访团将赴山东、河北、内蒙古三省区集中开展安全生产宣传采访活动。
国家发改委公布的价格监测结果显示，5月份与上月相比，全国36个大中城市的猪肉、鸡蛋、花生油等食品价格上涨明显，同时鲜菜、三元复合肥和烟煤等9种商品价。
国内首支马背消防队近日亮相内蒙古锡林郭勒草原，消防队由40位牧民组成，一旦发生火灾，将不受道路限制，迅速赶赴火场救援。昨天，一头长约70厘米、体重约5公斤的雄性江豚在武汉中科院水生生物研究所顺利降生，这也是世界上第二只在人工饲养条件下繁殖的长江江豚。据介绍，这头9岁的江豚妈妈曾经在2005年7月顺利产下一头雄性江豚。
近日，考古工作者在江西静安县发现一处距今2500多年的东周墓葬，墓葬内已探明有48具棺木，棺内还出土了大量保存完好的玉器、陶器及精美的金箔饰物等。
南十日直通车。香港有一项调查发现，超过20%的小学生沉迷于上网，最严重的每天上网超过10个小时，对学生的健康和学业都造成了负面影响。那么调查机构就呼吁学校和家长鼓励学生多使用电脑进行创作。
上小学5年级的张世忠
价格下降。随着《中国文物地图集》山西分册的出版发行，由国家文物局组织历经20多年调查编写的《文物资料大全》《中国文物地图集》编写工作基本完成，读者可以通过这本工具书迅速查到全国每一个文物点。
国内首支马背消防队近日亮相内蒙古锡林郭勒草原，消防队由40位牧民组成，一旦发生火灾，将不受道路限制，迅速赶赴火场救援。昨天，一头长约70厘米、体重约5公斤的雄性江豚在武汉中科院水生生物研究所顺利降生，这也是世界上第二只在人工饲养条件下繁殖的长江江豚。据介绍，这头9岁的江豚妈妈曾经在2005年7月顺利产下一头雄性江豚。
近日，考古工作者在江西静安县发现一处距今2500多年的东周墓葬，墓葬内已探明有48具棺木，棺内还出土了大量保存完好的玉器、陶器及精美的金箔饰物等。
香港像张同学这样沉迷上网的小学生还有不少，一项调查访问了1000多
十日直通车。
车由徐工集团独。
昨天呢，我们栏目对蓝藻爆发期间无锡个别企业仍将大量污水直排太湖的问题进行了报道。节目播出之后呢，无锡市委市政府立即召开紧急会议，节目中所涉及的两家排污企已经被责令关停，并追究相关人员的责任。从今天开始，无锡市环保监察部门组成的联合调查组将对沿太湖周边的工业企业和污染源进行逐一排查，发现问题一律先停产，整治达标后才能复产。为了让市民尽快地用上干净的自来水，无锡市政府正在加紧清理自来水管网中的残余污水。
我现在是在无锡市一个居民小区的楼顶上，无锡市大概有40万户居民家中的自来水就是通过这样的水箱输送到家里的。现在呢，
到饮用水标准，对于部分居民感觉到家中的自来水有异味的疑问，无锡市政府的解释是仍有部分污水存留在自来水管网和小区的水箱中。目前无锡市政府正安排人员对全市自来水管网和水箱进行清理，到明天全市18000个水箱将被彻底清空清洗两遍。
受低冷空气的影响，我国长江中下游以及华南的部分地区近日暴雨成灾，部分河段超出了警戒水位。
昨天一场暴雨袭击了湖南怀化城区，汽车西站边某房屋突然坍塌，一名男子被埋在废墟中。消防队员赶到时，居民家中的杂屋已经被水冲垮，松散的土坡有再次坍塌的危险。
先放到车。
在消防官兵近半个小时的努力下，遇险男子成功获救。从5月31号开始，广西、江西、湖北都出现明显的暴雨过程，并伴有强雷电、雷雨大风等强对流天气。湖北兴山县2号爆发山洪，出现17处大面积山体滑坡，造成一死一伤。同时，209国道多处塌方，全县大部分公路交通瘫痪，通信受阻。灾情发生后，兴山县立即启动应急预案，3000多名群众紧急转移。江西和广西也遭受了不同程度的洪灾，赣州市最大降雨量达到214毫米，大量农田被淹没，部分公路桥梁被毁。福建汀江上游的上杭县和长汀县同时出现超警戒水位的洪水。中央气象台预计，未来两天，江南、华南、贵州、云南等地还将先后有中到大雨，局部地区还会有短时雷雨大风、冰雹等强对流天气出现。
眼下呢，不少地方已经进入了雷击的多发期。近日，在重庆、广西、黑龙江等地就相继发生了雷击事件。
在重庆市永川区的胡先生家，记者看到房顶10多厘米厚的水泥板被雷电炸出了一个比脸盆还大的窟窿，两扇玻璃窗也被炸得粉碎。回忆起当时的情景，胡先生还心有余悸。
我们准备要洗脚，就是轰轰拉了一坨圆的就进来了，我是吧？就进来就那个散开了噻，爆了噻。
这次雷击还造成附近10户居民的电器瞬间被毁，所幸没有造成人员伤亡。在广西，雷击造成一间民房房顶破损，墙体开裂。在黑龙江鸡东县，6月2号下午，两个在田间干活的农民突然遭遇雷击，结果一死一伤。
到时候那什么玩意儿，天亮就那么一块云彩。就是闪电就过来了，一点雨动一下，俺俩有5厘米远，灯火划过来，我明白前吧，得有40来分钟吧，那两天。
目前已进入雷击多发期，气象专家特别提醒，建筑物要有避雷设施，才能防患于未然。对于户外劳作的农民朋友，更是要加强防雷意识。
遇到雷雨天气，不要快速的奔跑，不要骑自行车、骑马，或者是骑牛。远离高大的孤立建筑物，如铁塔、电线杆、孤立的树木。不要把铁锹、锄头等农生产用具扛在肩头。
在云南普洱发生6.4级地震之后，国务院立即派出救灾工作组前往云南地震灾区。这次地震是我国近2年来、云南省近10年来最大的一次地震，给当地造成了较为严重的损失。目前救灾工作正在紧张地展开。
由民政部、财政部、发改委等10部委组成的国务院救灾工作组6月3号晚抵达云南普洱地震灾区，就连夜深入到位于震中的宁洱县灾民安置点，及时了解灾民的安置和救助情况。
中央国务院关心大家，我们国务院工作组也向大家慰问。
据监测，地震发生后到今天上午10点，灾区共发生大小余震300余次，其中最大的一次余震震级达到5.1级。由于此次地震震级高、震源浅、震源深度仅为4.5公里，因此对房屋建筑等基础设施破坏性较大。目前云南省安排的300万元应急资金和民政部门紧急调拨的5000顶帐篷、2000套衣物、2000床棉被等救灾物资已陆续运抵灾区，并及时分发到灾民手中。民政部除了已经从广西调运的5000顶帐篷外，还将加拨10000顶救灾帐篷紧急运往灾区。
这里呢是宁洱县的长源广。
无锡市房管局的工作人员正在对水箱进行清空和换水，以保证居民家中早日用上安全无味的自来水。
无锡市卫生局检测中心
大的一个露天广场。那么在地震发生以后呢，当地政府
新闻，今天是第36个世界环境日，中国今年的主题定为污染减排与环境友好性。
公报显示，去年全国主要污染物排放量增长幅度开始明显回落，与上一年相比，化学蓄氧量和二氧化硫排放量增幅分别回落4.6和11.6个百分点。全国地表水总体水质属中度污染，在国家环境监测网监测的745个地表水监测断面中，1到3类水质占40%，4、5类为32%，劣5类为28%。7大水系中，珠江、长江水质良好，松花江、黄河、淮河为中度污染，辽河、海河为重度污染，太湖、滇池为劣5类水质。在全国监测的559个城市中，4.3%达到了空气质量一级标准，58.1%达到二级标准，达到或优于二级的城市比例比上年增加了4.7个百分点。
在世界环境日来临之际，中国东北最大的城市辽宁沈阳全面启动治污减排工程，其中计划投资38亿元，对9大热电厂实施脱硫改造。
沈阳这几家大型热电厂共有25台机组，供热面积3300多万平方米，年发电38亿度，耗煤量340多万吨，约占全市烟尘排放量的1/4。通过这次设备更新改造，将使脱硫除尘效率达到80%至90%以上，大大改善全市空气质量。
他们的工程完成结束之后呢，分别占全市脱硫任务的14%和20%。那么就是说，二氧化硫要削减到1.74万吨，那么尘要削减到2万吨。
与此同时，总投资8000多万元的各扎山治理工程、细河清淤工程等重点污染治理项目也相继开工。这座堆积40年、有30万吨的化工有毒废渣将得到无害化处理。
国家林业局新闻发言人曹清瑶今天驳斥了绿色和平组织有关中国进口木材危及热带雨林的不实言论。曹清瑶说，中国对木材和林产品的进口有着严格的监管程序，依照中国有关法律法规，国家好型社会。国家环保总局发布的2006年中国环境状况公报显示，去年中国的环境质量状况总体保持稳定。
公报显示，去年全国主要污染物排放量增长幅度开始明显回落，与上一年相比，化学蓄氧量。伊斯兰穆斯林军的领导人阿布贝克尔对美联社表示，他们没有参与这起阴谋，他也不认识这3名嫌疑人。另外，对于美国
感受，奥润德，更真的笑容，更多的机遇，更新的义乌，我的梦想就在这里，中国义乌。
一诊茶园茶香诊，茶叶源自
主题为污染减排与环境友好型社会。国家环保总局副局长张立军在新闻发
排放污水，并且安排了资金在每个区县建成了污水处理厂。然而记者最近在采访的时候发现，重庆万州向长江直排生活污水的情形令人触目惊心。
这是重庆万州滨江大道堤坝下的一条排污管道，当地的老百姓告诉记者，里面排出的污水来自万州主城区。
这个地方你看不到排污水的。你平时上来讲的话，这个是在今天还是下雨到了，雨到过后，平时那个啥出来的那个黑水啊，还要比那个凶得多。
每天都是这样排的。
每天都是这样。
没有，从来没有停过。
没有，没有。
在排污口这里，我们能闻到一股特别刺鼻的味道。同时大家可以看到，当水位涨到桥墩那个位置的时候，实际上这个排污口是在水面之下的，也就是说平时这个排污口根本就看不见。当地的老百姓说，像这样的排污口还不止一处，现在万州长江边上的很多地方的水都脏得不能碰了。
很痒的，回去还要用热水洗一下消毒，回到家里面还要消毒的。
在当地，记者了解到，国家早在几年前已经在明镜滩和沱口两地建成了日处理能力分别达到3万吨和2万吨的污水处理厂，但现在这两个厂的先进设备有一半都处于闲置状态。
因为我们这个水量不够嘛，水量不够的话，我们暂时性的就是停了一组。我们这边没运行的时候呢，它就上面就长了这个浮萍这样子。
厂方介绍说，目前万州城区每天排放的生活污水总量是4.5万吨左右，而建成的两座污水处理厂每天处理的污水总量是2万多吨，只达到了设计总能力的一半。
如果说我们两边开起来，这运营起来的话也可以，但是为了就是说怎么节约嘛。没必要嘛，怎么这个污水处理厂本身这个国家在补贴嘛运行。
一边是污水处理厂吃不饱，另一边却是城市污水直排长江。当地政府的有关负责人向记者解释，直排长江的城市生活污水并不归已经建成的两座污水处理厂来收集，而是属于另一个日处理能力6万吨的污水厂来负责。
污水处理厂由于没有建成，所以他那块污水还没有进入厂区进行达标处理，是这样的。
记者在进一步调查中发现，事实却有出入。污水处理厂的最新城市污水管网图显示，现在万州城区很多地方的生活污水，包括今年3月投入使用的政府新大楼，按规划是归建成的这两座污水处理厂来处理的。
政府大楼就区委、区政府跟区委都在这儿。现在还没有管网进入污水处理厂。还没有。
同时，在建的申明坝污水处理厂，记者还了解到，工程按照国家规定，本应在2003年就竣工，至今却迟迟没有完工。具体原因，有关方面拒绝了记者的采访。
如果申明坝一天不建起来，你这污水就还要继续这样排放是吗？
我国最大规模的专项溢油应急演习2007渤海溢油应急演习今天上午11点刚刚结束，海事救捞、公安、边防和渔政等20多艘船艇和2架直升机顺利完成了险情处置、消防过泊、海上清污和岸滩清污等预定程序。
整场演习历时1.5小时，模拟一艘万吨级油轮在进港途中起火爆炸，引起油舱破裂，500吨原油溢出，船舶及周边海域环境安全遭受严重威胁。船员紧急呼救，一场声势浩大的海空立体溢油应急行动迅速展开。溢油越过第1道围油栏、第2道围油栏向岸边扩散，通过指挥中心紧急协调，各种清污力量共同努力，海面溢油和岸滩油污全部清除，大海恢复了往日洁净。
今天的演习很成功，是对我国海上高科技高性能的溢油应急设备的一次全方位的展示。演习也检验了我国处置海上突发油污事故的能力和水平。
今天全部参演人数达到了500多人，演习还首次使用了多功能溢油应急专业收油船、溢油取样浮标和飞机喷洒消油剂装置等国内最先进的海上清油设备。这次演习的水域，渤海水域海水交替缓慢，自净能力差，更新周期长，一旦发生重大污染事故，必将对生态环境和沿岸旅游资源以及环渤海省市的经济社会发展造成巨大损失。
今天是普洱地震发生后的第3天，震后危房的排险工作全面展开，越来越多的救灾物
危房加上余震不断，随时有可能倒塌引发新的伤亡，查危排险是灾后救援的重要内容。目前救援队和武警官兵正在受灾严重的3个片区对危险房屋进行排险，救灾部门搭建的新的灾民安置点也不断增加，虽然余震不断，但灾民人身安全没有受到威胁，灾民的生活已基本得到保障。
我现在是在宁洱县曼联村下河边的临时搬迁点，在昨天的地震中，这个村民小组36户人家的房屋都被毁了，现在他们刚刚领到了这样一顶帐篷和一床棉被。今天宁洱的天气突然变得凉爽了许多，这样2件救灾物资对于灾民们来说显得尤为及时。
由于进村道路十分难走，帐篷等救灾物资今天清晨才到达村委会，村民们一早就忙碌了起来。
对，我们就是睡在雷霆之下，我们没人没来没楼没搞蚊子对我们睡不着，他们送了给我们吃点药煮点药。
除了帐篷和棉被外，现在每户灾民还领到了4袋方便面、4盒牛奶和2瓶矿泉水，这是他们一天的口粮。
在这些临时搬迁点，记者看到灾民们互帮互助，也蔚然成风。一家人在搭帐篷，其他几户人家也会来帮忙。有了矿泉水和食物，大家也会共同分享。没有烧水的茶壶，就到村公所借来一块用。
你也不会动了，然后老人的也接出来了，有时候多少的声音接出来了，然后村长对我们也好。
到目前为止，中央和各级民政部门紧急调拨的5000顶帐篷、2000床被子、2000套衣服和价值50多万元的食物，已陆续送达灾区。目前，宁洱县各村委会、学校和广场等空地上都搭建起了灾民们临时的家。
记者今天从教育部获悉，针对云南省地震灾区的情况，教育部已经要求云南省启动国家教育考试应急预案。
教育部要求，云南省地震灾区首先要确保考生和考试工作人员的生命安全，对存在安全隐患的考场坚决不能使用，由当地政府和教育行政部门选用备用考点，确保高考试卷的绝对安全和万无一失，努力做到所有考生不因地震而缺考。目前，云南省教育行政部门已经启动了国家教育考试应急预案。
来关注股市的消息，沪深股市
之一。那么现在大家可以看到呢，
欢迎收看中央电视台中文国际频道的海峡两岸。